Welcome to this talk on 3D printing experiments in mathematics. The core content of this talk is fourfold. First of all, I want to show that new technology invigorates teaching, that it changes the way how we think about mathematics, that it motivates students, and finally, that it's important to use the right tools. Before that, let me thank, first of all, to John, who organized this workshop and the invitation. Then to Liz, who wrote a fantastic thesis on the feasibility of 3D printing in the classroom. I'm sure I learned more from her than I could teach her. Liz taught the guest lecture in a single variable calculus course in 2013 and also generated some interest among colleagues. We see her here with Jamil and Sophie Morel. Also thanks to Enrique Canossa, Carlo Fonda, and Marco Zenaro, who organized a workshop in the spring of 2013. Their book is freely available. That workshop was really exciting. You see me here hacking with Marius Kintle, the main developer of OpenSCAD. We got that night the mathematics export procedure generating OpenSCAD code from Mathematica. And also present was Gregor Lütow, an early pioneer of 3D printing in the classroom. Gregor printed for us the gem, a star containing all Archimedean solids. Also very helpful had been a grant from the Elson family supporting art in the classroom. We used it to print out some student projects in 2012. And finally, thanks to many students in the last couple of years who have submitted so many exciting projects. We see a couple of them. The picture here is from a Mathematica workshop for a multivariable calculus class. So 3D printing is part of an industrial revolution. Various 3D printing
technologies. By balancing liquid, light, and air,
various
3D printing techniques,
materials, like here.
So as the platform slowly moves upwards, the projector...
The progress is extremely fast. There are companies who already print entire cars. We have explored the microcosmos with microscopes and particle accelerators. We have explored the macrocosmos with telescope and space explorations. And now we conquer the mesoscale with 3D scanning and a lot of mathematics. It's kind of the last frontier. It's also a great tool in education. Any technology has impact in education. It adds to the mix of tools we have at our disposal for teaching, in this case, primarily for presentation and illustration. Here we see a teacher, Laura Taalman, using knots as a demonstration.
And we realized
tool.
That we could actually print them.
And another example you can find on YouTube is a printed
so
object
when B is zero,
which illustrates how a parabola changes
parabola,
when a linear
right,
function is added.
And when you increase B,
you see the parabola
it increases
shift,
the slope.
And
that ends
up
shifting
what
the parabola
when you add
to the left.
Constant times x.
And actually down.
The choice of technology is important, not only for practical reasons, but also for pedagogy. And so there are two extreme ways how we can think about the geometric object, a mathematical description, or simply by giving a triangle mesh. This dichotomy is present in many other places, like when you have vector graphics versus raster graphics, a MIDI file for music, providing timing and scales, versus a wave file, just giving the amplitudes of a song. And computer algebra systems are very well suited for describing objects geometrically through mathematical formulas. It's pedagogically more valuable than a model or sculpture software which is opaque about the mathematics which is involved. Computer algebra systems change and evolve also rapidly. Mathematica 11, for example, natively already allows to print to a printing service. But it doesn't have to be a computer algebra system, a lightweight, self-contained, but extremely powerful free software is OpenSCAD. Also, this language describes objects mathematically and allows Boolean operations, for example, between various geometric objects, allowing with a few lines to generate complex objects. Still, a mesh-based software is helpful, for example, to fix a given file, to simplify meshes, to fix holes, to paint it, etc. Here we see MeshLab, a free software which works well and is robust. You can also paint on it. Another example is NetFab, which has similar features. Like in your home toolbox, it is useful to have many different programs at your disposal. And having seen how much time one has in general to spend printing with self-owned printers, I opted for myself to send things to print shops. It's quickly done, not too expensive and stress-free. I myself have used Shapeways and Sculpture. There are others like 3D Hub or iMaterialize. And due to the competition, the prices are likely to go down even more in the future. It's not really necessary to print things. Once you have generated an object which is printable, capable of the surfaces, it's also quite attractive to use as an animation or illustration. The design motivated by 3D printing has rendered the object more attractive. So here's the STL file from that Calavial surface, which can be printed. In Trieste, they printed a half-foot version of this for a couple of dollars in a print shop. It's maybe 10 times more. But this is a printout from Shapeways, which I brought with me here. The surface, unfortunately, has been damaged a bit by the transport and by the inspection in the airport. So in Shapeways, it costs $35 in white. I printed it in color, where I think it was a little bit more. It can also be useful to digitize a given object. So I experimented with various techniques, a MakerBot scanner, a Kinect device, the 3D Sense scanner, handheld scanner, and also using a smartphone app. So here's an example of a scan made with 3D Sense, a $300 handheld scanner. This is our lovely Zen frog in our herb garden. And this was an early experiment, 2012, with a Kinect. And here the Kinect was brought to a lecture to scan a student, it was Charles, who volunteered to be scanned in front of a multivariable course review. Another experiment with the Kinect. Unfortunately, with the Kinect and the handheld scanner, they both require that the computer has to be there, so it's a little bit of a hassle to carry it around. Here's an experiment with a smartphone. So a year ago, we visited the Rhode Island School of Design Museum and in Providence. So you see in the back an object, it's just a chimera. So here you see that 1,500-year-old creature. It had guarded the grave of a wealthy Chinese family. The creature is a mixture of a dragon and a dog or donkey. It looks a bit like the kids of Donkey and Dragon in Shrek. So here is I just took some photos and submitted it with that app to a server, which then reconstructed the 3D object. To the left, you see a simplified mesh generated with MeshLab. So here's a close-up of that mesh. It's a beautiful triangulation of a surface. And here you see the printout. So I'd used Mathematica to add a socket below the chimera so that it has a comfortable place to sit on. Here are more printed objects from the fall of 2012. I had submitted the grant proposal to the Elson Family Arts Initiative in the spring of 2012. So here you see a couple of example objects illustrating the various materials. Here a metal example done by a student, a Pokemon monster, Pikachu generated with a few spheres and cylinders done by a student. Here a knot, also done by a student, printed in color. Harry Potter implementation, printed out in heavy metal. Melinda Song, a student, printed a tiny golden bear later from her project. This was done in the fall of 2013, where we had no more a grant to print. She just printed it herself. So in 2014, we were obsessed with a monkey saddle, a whole course, and for a midterm, I printed it, so also in white, and it was featured in an exam problem of 2014. And it can be used also in other ways. Here's a simple fullerene type polyhedron. Here's a printout just obtained a week ago. It is an object generated with lace, illustrating that the volume of a tetrahedron is 1/6 of the volume of a parallelepiped. I like the metal ceramic type material. Another attempt to illustrate that formula. which was known to the Greeks already, is here printed with Lys. So the connection cylinders, which you see, turned out to be too thin. They quickly broke off. Is a printout of the 24 cell, which is also the unit group in the quaternion integers. I had been obsessed with the quaternion primes during the summer, this summer. And here's an older version from 2012, the same 24 cell, done in another material. So here you see a detail of the Calabi-Yau surface printed in color by Shapeways. I would print it now a little bit larger. You see there are some parts which broke up easily. One of the goals for this conference was actually to generate an object which can be moved, which is kind of that one calls 4D printing. A good example to try this out would be the Steffen surface. There's a theorem of Gaucher which excludes continuous deformations of a convex polyhedron, but it's possible for non-convex surfaces like this one. I did not manage to get it done movable so that it's now 3D printed in metal. Is an example also done with Lys. It's a 3D version of the Sody Hexlet. One needs to know a little bit complex numbers to generate this nicely. Here's the printout with Lys in 2012. Also here, it was a little bit too thin. You see some of the parts have broken. Also what is done with Lys was this drinkable proof of the formula for the volume of a sphere, the volume of the complement of a cone in a cylinder. So you can fill in the top with water or whatever liquid you like to drink, and then it goes down and fills the complement of a cone in the cylinder. I'd also been obsessed with the Euler brick. It's an unknown whether there's a cuboid with integer side lengths for which all face and space diagonals are integers. So here's a printout, very small, smaller than a matchbox. By the way, if you have a few matches, you could even assemble this with a bit of glue without 3D printing. And here's another examples like the intersection of several cylinders. The right picture shows how we have thickened the Möbius strip. It was generated by hand using analysis, using the, you know, parametrization. And Mathematica allows to do that also automatically by just specifying the thickness. But it obviously had here some problems. In the case of the Möbius strip, of course, it's not to blame as the strip is not orientable. And here are some of the objects generated with Lys. So there are two objects here which are not from us. It's the back, the figure eight knot, and the surface to the right there, which I think they are done by Henry Segerman, who, by the way, is currently with George Hart, the leading math 3D printing artist. He's just published a book. Here's the gem in a computer-generated picture, and again, here's the printout by Gregor Ludolf. So we had originally imagined to have everything printed out at once, but Greg took it apart and printed each of the sticks independently, allowing it to be assembled to one. But it took him about a week to print everything. So one of the simplest objects, which only needs a handful of points to be generated, is the Penrose Triangle, an impossible triangle. So here it is printed out and placed on my table, and also you can place it in Google Earth and fly around and find a place in Google Earth or in Earth on Earth where it is placed. So here are more pictures from student objects. Here's from the summer 2016 multivariable calculus class. This is a 6-week course, took 65 students took it. And all multivariable without shortcuts is taught in 6 weeks. And the students also learn and produce a computer algebra project. So here are more examples of objects generated by this class. So here's the winning contribution. I picked two projects as winners. So this one is marvelous, just done by Anna Fish. And here is a picture, an object generated by Jordan. She really made a beautiful art object. Note that the students had to do that within a few hours while preparing also for a comprehensive final exam covering all the course up to the theorems of Stokes and Gauss. All these objects were done in Mathematica. So here are student objects from the fall of 2015, about maybe 1,000 objects. I get all these projects by email and personally process them. So it requires to work through some nights to get this done. But even with a 300 plus student class, it's important to get everybody to submit answer questions, etc. Maybe it requires to process a few thousand emails in a few days, but it's worth it. Some parts can be automatized, like producing the gallery, producing scripts which generate this. One of the main points I wanted to make is that it's not really necessary to print an object. Here are other uses. So when we had been obsessed with a monkey saddle, we can place it into Google Earth. We can fly around it. We can make games like, you know, you have to fly under the surface, for example, or through the belly of the surface. Here's a graph of the theta function placed near the science center at Harvard. Again, one can fly through that object. We got unsolved problems because we extruded all the roots. Here visible as poles are on the line. Here is Harry Potter flying around. We could not play Quidditch over Harvard Yard. The aeroplane is just placed for fun. So here is the Escher stair placed over my alma mater, the ETH Zurich. The task is to find the place where you see the impossible stair, and I think now we got that spot. Perfect. Or here's the Mandelbrot set, is placed in the Boston Harbor. So flying in Google Earth can still be sometimes a little bit choppy, but things are getting better and better, and the hardware, of course, also gets better, and very soon we can really play computer games in Google Earth. Of course, there are millions of other examples one could try out. Here are some objects that are not yet printed. The Calabi was printed, but the others not. They are related to topology, like the Alexandrov sphere, the Antoine necklace, or the Hopf vibration, or then geodesics on a toroidal surface, or geodesics on a cube. Here's an illustration of Gaussian primes, objects I had been obsessed with over the summer. It would be nice to print this out, or primes in the quaternion algebra. Also, this would be nice to print. Challenge here is to connect the cube so that it becomes printable. Thinking like a 3D printer helps to make graphics better. Here is an example. So last Wednesday night, about 35 hours ago, we just gave an exam to 320 students. We graded it all night, and the next day I flew here. So here are the two exam questions from that exam. If you look at the graphics, you notice that they are heavily influenced by 3D printing. They look real. And so here is a blow-up from problem 9, where students had to parameterize a cone and a cylinder. So here are objects from previous exam problems, one featuring the Warka Tower to generate water out of the air, and the other the Porta Square Mobile. But not only for exams. The change of mind also helps with presentations. So here's a slide for a review from just a week ago, last Sunday, where instead of bullet points, the menu is illustrated using graphics. And for illustrating parameterizations or traces, this 3D candy type shape is attractive. All these graphics has been done with Mathematica. The curves are tube plots. The surfaces are thickened with a built-in thickened command. The hyperboloid, again, with traces, or the torus. And here's a clover-type surface, which is very beautiful. So the graphics was also featured in a clip made for an exam review.
Math candy.
So this is the end of the talk. Thanks for watching.